treehouse on this wonderful sunny and warm Sunday afternoon. I think it's summertime, don't you, Imelda?
I think it's April, but it's summer for sure. We went from winter to summer.
Anyway, I'd like to give a very warm welcome to my guest today, Imelda Vanquist?
Elmquist.
Yes. Sorry. Okay. From London. And Imelda is a fellow Moonsbrook author. And a shamanic artist.
And teacher.
Practitioner. And teacher, yes. Yeah. So it's lovely to have you here, Imelda.
Well, thank you for inviting me.
It's been a long time coming.
You're on my wish list of people I wanted to meet. So.
Yeah. Now, this is a special interview for me as well because you're the first guest I've had that I've never met before. So this is my debut.
It's a bit more of a risk.
Yes. Well, you said it. Okay, so you're here to talk about your work and what you do. And I know that, you know, we've got to try and condense it all into a short amount of time because there is so much that you do. But shall we start with your book?
Yeah, we could do, yeah.
Yeah, which came out in
2016.
Natural Born Shamans, a spiritual toolkit for life, using shamanism creatively with young people of all ages. So tell me, Imelda, what's the story behind this book?
Why did you write it? One day my helping spirits came and insisted I started this group for children where they could all develop their own spiritual toolkit. And they said that, you know, children of all ages, but especially like teenagers need that. They need a spiritual compass and they need good tools because life throws so many challenges at them. And, you know, like I was a little bit terrified thinking that, oh, like I'm not sure I'm the right person for this. But, you know, when your helping spirits come and they insist, like, you're not going to say no. So I started a group of children, and also, you know, that went on for many years. So the children were growing up as we were doing the work, where we did these sessions. I called the group the Time Travelers, and we just looked at all areas of spirituality. It was often also dictated by what the children themselves need. So parents would call up and say, you know, child's been having nightmares. Can you do a session on dreaming and nightmares? Or, you know, at the beginning of the school years, they're in a new class, they have a new teacher, to do a session on bullying, a spiritual toolkit for bullying, you know, or whatever it was, whatever the children themselves wanted. So I had this group of children, and this program was going for 5 years. They've kind of graduated now. I called them together as a special task force when there is a film to be made or something to be done. But these children could teach shamanism themselves now. They're so fluent and they're so tuned in that so got to the point where it became silly to do sessions with them. I felt like, you know, they could really do sessions with others. So that's how it came about. So this book tells the story of how the group came into existence. And also, as I was doing that work, I had many shamanic practitioner and teacher colleagues referring people to me. So I got emails from all over the world. You know, grandparents concerned about the spiritual welfare of their grandchildren, or people who worked with children in a different capacity who ran into issues or challenges or wanted questions answered. So really it was quite simple that the structure of this book essentially was for me to answer every question I had been asked by other people. So in a way other people gave me the contents of the book and I just had to write it. So it only took 9 weeks to write, because like once I started writing it moved quite fast.
How many thousand words is there?
Can't remember.
Okay,
it's quite thick.
It's quite thick. Yeah, I'd say that's over 50,000. That's about 300
something pages.
Okay, 9 weeks.
Yeah,
but you probably had all the material, as you say.
Well, I just had all these teaching notes and also the notes I'd written after all of these sessions. And you know, when you do work with young people and children, and I was doing shamanic healing sessions with children as well, it very soon becomes clear like what young people are dealing with. So it very much the work like runs itself. So you do one thing, it's very obvious what the next thing is, or the children ask and say, oh, we've done this now, but next time could we do that, or could we have a guest teacher who presents this or that. So I'd call on like colleagues and friends to come and share skills with the children so we could widen the program of what we were offering. So, and that's really nice, like, you know, working with friends and colleagues on that. And like some of my colleagues like took their first steps into teaching, that one of their first steps was to run a session for the time travellers. So okay. it became kind of like a bit of a phenomenon.
And do the time travellers still, do you still run the group, or is
I
it
don't do sessions.
Evolved into something else?
What it has evolved into is, I said, it's like a spiritual task force. So say if I'm asked by some publisher, like as I was like a few months ago, like to make a film about a particular subject, and I call the children together and we do it on a project basis. So we come together, we do the journey work, you know, and I have filmed the children myself. They're also proper filmmakers of filmed the children. These films have come out much better, but I also, you know, sometimes have the camera at hand and film them doing things myself. So I've got like little things on YouTube, where, you know, where I have the children, like, did a session like death and dying and children's perspectives of dying. So I took them to the local cemetery and just like, you know, asked them questions and had them talk about that, what their take on that was. I felt that was quite a thought-provoking small film.
Absolutely, yeah.
It's a taboo subject, but you know, that's what you need to do in this work. You need to break through the taboos, face the darkness.
Yeah, yeah, cross the edge. Now, do you find in your work with the children that the journeying is the main sort of technique? How easy is it to teach kids to journey?
Well, it depends on the ages of the children. Yeah. If you're dealing with very young children, you don't even need to teach them how to journey because they're still naturally in that zone. So, and also I've worked with them through like art and music and creative writing. You know, for all the children I have used journeying because it's kind of like, you know, a fast way of taking a whole group to the same place. And the only thing with that is that children are like so much faster than adults. So if you're used to teaching adults, you think, oh yeah, here I set an intention and I'm going to drum for 10 minutes. That's not necessary with the children. Quite often before I have picked up, like my drum is right here, before I have picked up my drum and started drumming, the children say, that's okay, we've read your mind, so we know what we're going to do, like, can we share now? So like the journey didn't even need to happen, they'd already done it. It's like, wow, this is taking things to a new level, you know?
Yeah, because they're naturally tuned in, aren't they?
Naturally tuned in, and they're very, very fast. So you don't need to take children through the same kind of like fuff, as it were, as you need to do with grown-ups.
Yeah.
It's more kind of, they need very few instructions and off they go.
Yeah.
And they do
really
brilliant work.
Yeah.
And they take extra journeys around the cosmos, or they come and talk to the weather spirits or whatever, so they take themselves little extra tour trips, and then they come back with these amazing stories, and it's like, wow.
Yeah.
That's the privilege. That's the amazing part of it.
Yeah. Yeah, well, they are natural-born shamans, aren't they?
That's really. Right, gave the book that title.
Yeah, fantastic title. And with the kids as well, how do you explain, or maybe you don't even have to explain it, how do you broach the subject of magic with them, or the magical world?
Well, children are naturally in that zone, and also the children in my Time Travelers group came because they wanted to do magic. So I sometimes joke and say, oh, this is like our own version of Hogwarts, you know, so it's a joke around that. And also because I have very young children, so when you do shamanic healing sessions with very young children, like, you know, it works in a different way. You just ask the parents, what is the child into? And it doesn't matter if it is Spider-Man or Superman or Batman or whatever it is, or Harry Potter. So, and I just use that as a frame of reference. So whatever the spirits say I need to do, you know, as part of the healing work for the child, I put it in that context. I use the language from that so the child feels at ease and at home. Oh, yeah, I know. You know, there's loads of things you can do. You can do work with them while, you know, they become Batman for a moment and you run after them and you work. You know, work with children is very, very fast. Children are not going to lie still and wait for you to come and get on with something. So the whole thing, speed is of the essence.
Yeah.
So both when you teach them or you do group work with them or when you see them individually for sessions, the thing is you're on the move the whole time and it all moves at the speed of lightning. So like your own reactions need to become much, much faster than they need to be for adults.
So they dictate the speed of the work.
Yes. Yeah. And then they also show you, like, you know, the great thing about this work is you start seeing the future. You see how archaic some of what the grown-ups are, you know, how that really is, because they are so much faster. And also they like lead the way and they do new things. And in a very real way, I feel I'm seeing the future when I work with children. And it sort of like makes me see where the ways that we ourselves, people of my generation, do things, that's already become old-fashioned, really. So all the stuff
it's not difficult, is it?
What we believe in, it's not difficult. You know? So the trappings and the methods, really, young people are going to completely reinvent it. It's going to be much faster and it's going to be completely different because literally they're drawing down the future. And that's, again, another privilege of the work where you think, here, I, you know, relatively old person, I'm 51. I really like get to see what's going to be happening beyond my lifetime. You know, how amazing is that?
Yeah, and they can take you to that place.
Oh yeah, easily.
Wow.
And in shamanism, we work outside time, so you also, you
of
know,
course.
So you can, and that's why the group is called the Time Travelers.
Yeah,
you know?
Absolutely.
It's going outside time.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, and what about subjects that, you know, are a little bit sort of, might be delving into the darkness here.
Mm-hmm.
How do children cope with do you do shadow work with children?
Oh, yes.
Yeah?
I mean, it's fantastic doing shadow work with children because adults have all of these sort of, you know, these defense mechanisms around it. Like, they don't like reflecting on where they themselves hold the darkness, but for all 50% dark and 50% light. And then we get into this whole, you know, where we project and we think there are good people and bad people, but really, you know, all of that stuff is within ourselves. And children do that really, really naturally. Like, you know, I've done shadow work sessions with them. And I remember at some point I had this, like, 7-year-old where, you know, we did all of these techniques. And you ask them, like, what can you not stand in other people? And then, you know, you throw it all in the group. And then you should take them on some little trips. And then you say, okay, and now be honest, like, where in you can you find that? All of these things you've just told me, you cannot stand in other people. Now go deep within you. Like, where can you find that within you? And the younger children have no trouble doing that. So, you know, I had a 7-year-old once who said that, oh, ha, 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 I can find it all within me. I'm this master of darkness, really, and I'm not ashamed to admit it. Well, you get a grown-up to do that. And, you know, yeah, it's a delightful, wonderful boy. He's not really a master of darkness. He just has no difficulty admitting that he has the shadow side within him.
Yeah.
He can access that and admit that, and he doesn't mind going on journeys there and then coming back. But don't get me wrong, this is a very well-adjusted child, a really lovely boy.
Yeah.
This is not a boy who commits cruelty or does nasty things.
No.
It's just a boy who's really in touch with all aspects of himself. And I think, well, if only all of us adults could do that, the world would look different.
Yeah,
if we could own our shadow and take back all of these projections, because we projected onto politicians, world leaders, our neighbors, our colleagues, sometimes even on people who are different from ourselves, maybe skin color, like so much of that is projection. If we can pull that back to ourselves and find it all within ourselves, we don't need to project anymore. And then we, you know, we can be in a different relationship, both with other people, ourselves, and the world, really. It's really powerful work.
Yeah, absolutely. And leads us into being so much more compassionate beings, doesn't it, really?
Yeah, because we become less critical of other people when we know, when we can admit that, you know, whatever these people are doing, that pushes our buttons. It is within us too. There's been a time in our life where we have done something similar.
Yeah.
And then the moment we can do it, say, okay, it's like part of the human condition, and the moment we can admit that, we don't need to vilify it so much in other people.
Because I think kiddies, well, children, they're not as conscious, are they, of being controlled by their egos, perhaps. I don't know. Do you think? What do you think about that?
Children have egos, but they're still way more playful. So when you set them exercise where you say, drop that whole thing now and like work from a different place. So you give them exercises around like hollowing out or seeing the world through. You know, essentially, it's a lot about it. You give them permission, because really young children do this spontaneously and automatically.
Yeah.
But like you open sacred space and, you know, a strong group container, and you give them permission. You know, you say, you know, it's like okay to do this here. It's okay to go to that different place.
Yeah.
Then you find that like young people can do that. And also even for the ones where you wouldn't find it so easily, it's usually somewhere within them. But there's sometimes there's layers of family conditioning. It's not cool in school. They push it far away. There's cultural, you know, so it gets buried under all of these layers of conditioning and social pressures. But in my experience with most young people, you can find a little pocket of it within them. Once you've got that pocket, you can start working with that.
Now, just listening to you talking about the bits of the book, it just reminds me of a story, a funny story that you wrote in this book about when you did a ceremony for, what do you call them, those Chinese lanterns, and you set some of them off. Can you tell us about that and remind me? Because I read this quite a long time ago.
Yes,
but
I know. You're
remind me
years
about
ago.
It. Yeah.
We were doing a ceremony to honour the children that died at Sandy Hook, you know, where there had been a school shooter.
Right,
that shot all of these children.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I thought it was a good idea. It wasn't a good idea, but I thought it was a good idea to use one of these sky lanterns where, you know, you light them and then they fill up with hot air and they sail. And we have a pretty large garden for London standards, but clearly we should have gone to the park or like a hilltop. So what happened was we did a ceremony. We all wrote, like, you know, prayers on the sky lantern. So first it wasn't on yet, so we had like black felt tips. So we wrote our prayers for the souls of the children at Sandy Hook and really all the wandering around that. And then we set this thing off, so it went really beautifully for a little while. It went up, and you know, the children were like drumming and rattling, and it was a powerful moment. Then it snagged on the top of the tree in the neighbor's garden and set the tree on fire. So like some of the tree burned down. So as soon as the children had been collected by the parents, they eat humble pies or knock on the neighbor's door. I'm so sorry. Set the tree, or the children, I set a tree in your garden on fire. Like, well, what were you doing then? So I explained about Sandy Hook and the massacre and what we were doing. And, you know, the neighbors were so wonderful. They said, Imelda, we hope that you will be doing what you're doing for a very long time to come. It's just wonderful, this work. Small price to pay.
Absolutely.
That our tree went on fire, but that's very tolerant, you know, even for London standards. So they were cool. They were really cool about it. But I've not been setting off any more sky lanterns.
No.
And they've become illegal since. You're not allowed to set them off anymore.
Has it?
Yeah, because they can, like, pollute, or, you know, animals have got hurt and stuff like that. So I don't think you can buy them and use them anymore.
No, that's fair enough. That's fair enough.
At the time I was doing that, there was quite a fad for it in London. People were setting them off at, like, Hilly Fields Park or whatever. In our local parks, where it's a bit hilly, people were setting them off all the time. It was quite normal behaviour to do that.
Now, you're a mum, like me. We've got
sons.
I've got two, and yours are teenagers as well, aren't they?
18, 16,
what
14.
Do they think, Imelda, about your shamanic work?
Well, I mean, you
know, brought up with it,
they haven't known anything different. Yeah. They, you know, are all members of the Time Travelers group. They all worked together fairly recently. Well, we made a film for Sounds True for the project I was on. I'm working at a medieval burial pit in central London called Crossbones, and, you know, they all did, like, amazing work. So, like, from a very young age, they've been doing this and doing this along with me. And then they went through a little phase, I think, where my 16-year-old, my middle one, is now eating, well, like, you know, my mom is like a little naff. But my 18-year-old is like, you know, at the time when I published this book, he was 16, about to turn 17. And he started talking to his friends in school about, oh, you know, my mom has written this book. And like, oh, what? Your mom's like a shaman, well, really a shamanic practitioner, but the way they talk in secondary school. So I actually got these requests, like, could I come to my house, and could I give a drumming demonstration, and could I answer questions about what happens after death and spiritual things. So actually, I think my son got a bit of cool factor out of the fact of what he was doing. He discovered that his mom actually had quite an interesting job compared to some parents' jobs.
Yeah.
And that is actually really
It's definitely
really
not
cool.
mainstream, is it?
It's not mainstream, but also when things happen in his friendship group, like, very, very sadly, one of my son's friends committed suicide, a girl who had mental health issues, and he and I have long conversations. We said, Mom, where would she be now? And what happens to people after death, but also when people commit suicide, does that, like, change the transition process? What happens after suicide? And he and I have these long conversations, and he has conversations with friends. So I actually think that's really, really positive. It's a really good thing that we can talk about that. And also that, and he said, oh, Mom, can I bring some friends home? And please, you know, could you talk to them about, like, you know, what happens after death? Like, how you perceive that in the work you do, because you work in the land of the dead. I mean, that's awesome. I've got, like, a bunch of 16, 17, 18-year-olds when I come to my house and talk about what happens after death. I think that's cool.
Yeah, yeah. About zombies or anything like that.
Yeah, or they ask things like, oh, if you're really, really powerful, can you resurrect the dead? And I said, well, you know, I've developed a cool skill set over time. That's one stunt I haven't pulled off yet, because I think once people die, you know, like, they're meant to be over there and not here. I don't even think it's kind to resurrect them after death. I don't think, even if you could do it, I don't think it's a good idea, really.
No.
But, you know, you get some of those questions, but also, like, you know, that is okay. If that's their doorway into the material, they will ask questions based on video games they play. Kind of like where you have the mage or the rain shaman or wizard. So can you actually make rain? Are there, like, shamanic rituals you can perform to, you know, work with the weather spirits? And that's stuff I've done with the Time Travelers group. We've done weather shamanism. And, you know, like, I'm very happy to talk about it. I think it's a good thing that the awareness comes back in our culture that, you know, there are, like, ways and means of being in relationship with that. It's not as simple as now I make rain, because the weather spirits, they do their own thing and, you know, they have their own agenda. But yes, I mean, traditionally speaking, tribal peoples have been able to make rain, and they had to. There are ways and means of doing that.
Yeah. Now, obviously this book is packed full of all your experiences mm-hmm. that you've had with the children, and it covers, you know, a range of all those subjects, and yes. we haven't got time to go into them.
Like
so
4 years worth of subjects.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a wonderful book, and I did review it as well, which
you
I thought it
Thank
was
you.
Worth a really good review. So I would highly recommend that to anybody that was interested in you know, this vast umbrella of a subject. But you, your work now seems to be moving from core shamanism to something a little bit more
I think indigenous. In this work I find that, you know, it's often about going home, and core shamanism, which was pioneered by Michael Harner, is a good thing, because here in the West we had lost shamanism, essentially. It had been sort of pushed away also by Christianity became the dominant religion, and science took over our mainstream paradigm. It's very scientific. So, like, Michael Harner did us all a favor, I think, when he brought core shamanism, because it allowed tried and tested safe ways for people to connect with the spirit world again. But with my own shamanic practitioner students that I teach, I've always urged them to like to go home as well, because I teach students from all over the world, from a very wide variety of ethnical backgrounds. Some are Irish, some are from Turkey, some are French, or from the Mediterranean, or, you know, whatever. And I was also, you know, what did your ancestors do? Like, were there medicine people, you know, in your own background? And then people go on these journeys. So for myself, as I moved my way through that, I had a Roman Catholic upbringing full of priests and saints and nuns.
Very strict.
Yeah, very, you know, so that's like one paradigm or one, you know, world perception. Then when I was 19, the Norse cults came and called me. I met my husband, who is Swedish. You can't see him on camera. He's out there talking to another author.
Chatting, yes.
Author up here today. So the Norse cults came and grabbed me. I knew nothing about that because I'd had this Roman Catholic upbringing. But it's like the whole, you know, the cults of ancient Scandinavia. And it's like, whoa. So this whole world opened up. And I started doing my own work with that. So it was very much a solitary practitioner working with that. Then the spirits can say, oh, you need to do more structured training. So then I found teachers in core shamanism, because I had really young children. I couldn't just go to Brazil. It needed to be like on the doorstep. And, you know, worked with people within that paradigm for many years and got very good results, very powerful, beautiful material. But for myself, my own journey now continues and I need to go home. So I'm starting the School of Norse Shamanism in Sweden that opens June next year. But I'm going to be teaching people the, you know, the ancestral, like really the indigenous material of Northern Europe again. So I'm very excited about that.
Wow.
That's my own journey home to what is an indigenous European, like the Nordic tradition.
And how have you sort of delved into that? Do you, is that, has that come through your own sort of just journey work?
Some of it has. I've also worked, you know, like with my own teacher in Scandinavia and the person I was like co-teaching courses with. So I've, you know, I've worked with teachers and I learned a lot through co-teaching with teachers.
Yeah.
But also a lot of it is like going back to the sources and like, you know, doing my own devotional practices.
Yeah.
So I spend a lot of like, we spend all the, because my husband is Swedish and we have this house there where the school is going to be. We spend all the school holidays in Sweden.
On the land.
So like, and like on the land, it is like in the wild, in the forest, like pristine,
Fantastic. Pristine
forest land. There are no people, you don't see any other people. It's very remote.
Is there any internet?
Well, our children insist on buying some. We buy a limited amount and it runs out. So limited internet. And ideally, no internet at all, but with three teenagers, it doesn't quite work.
Yeah, doesn't bear thinking about, does it?
Well,
being
not
without
from
it.
From my point of view, but not from their point of view. But it's the whole thing of like, you know, being out there on the land and also like very much learning. I think the big thing for me there is learning that yes, we can use the, you know, the, like the Poetic Edda, Prose Edda and the other sagas to sort of learn about, you know, what that tradition looked like. Well, really in the early medieval period, from the year 900 until about like 1300. But a lot of that material was written down. But also my own learning through groups and my own work is that even the cults want to evolve, and the cults can only evolve in partnership with human beings. So yes, we need to honor the old, and there is very rich material there which I will be teaching, but also be using, I'm already using the power of groups to sort of talk, communicate directly with these cults and see, but you know, where did, do they want things to go? How do they want to evolve? We're in the 21st century now. We can't all become Vikings again and come and live in 11th century Scandinavia. I mean, like exciting as that might be, there would be hardships as well, and some things would be really tough, you know, internet. But we're in the 21st century now, but like, how can we take the core of that tradition and yet how can we support it into forms that make it accessible and like really make a difference to the lives of people in the 21st century? So it's that marriage of absolute respect for tradition and yet also the marriage to innovation. That's very much the place where I work with my students.
So it's connecting the old with the new, isn't it?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah. And the gods that you work with, am I right in saying with the Norse gods, is it Odin and Freya? Is it?
They are from the Norse pantheon. One goddess I work
just two,
with,
aren't they?
Peter here, is Skadi.
Oh.
Skadi, sorry, the camera is here or here, I don't know.
But Skadi.
Like, Skadi, she's like a goddess I have a particular connection to. She's one of the ones that I work closest with. Another one is Styr, like the warrior god who lost his arm, you know. A wolf bit off his
Now
his
these
arm.
Are all, this is all your artwork.
Yeah, these are my paintings,
isn't it? So can you talk about your artwork and your connection with the spirit world to how that sort of expresses in your art?
The art I make is sacred art. I don't really make modern art in that sense. The courses I teach all over the world are in sacred art as well. People come to me because they want to make sacred art. So that's what I teach, and that's based on my own work.
So what's the difference between mainstream art? You knew I was going to ask this, didn't you?
I was asking
and sacred art?
Well,
or is all art sacred, do you think?
Well, that is a rather big discussion.
I know.
I would say that...
Sorry, I didn't mean to put you on the spot there.
That's fine. A lot of sort of modern art, because, you know, we've moved away, like, you've moved away from religion, and things have become very scientific, but there will be a proliferation of the human ego. In our culture at the moment, we see many things that are created from a place of ego, which is the kind of me, 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 look at me.
Yeah.
And, you know, that has its place. The human ego needs to be fed. We need an ego to function in this world. But the work that I do is about, like, creating spirit-led art, and then really meaning that, you know, spirit can seek physical expression, like, you know, art being the container for that. So it takes a physical expression. It's like a painting, could also be a piece of music, or could be a sculpture, or, you know, it could be whatever. But then when it's done in partnership with spirit, it's the human ego that needs to go out of the way. And it's also the part of us that has all these negative ideas about ourselves, all the limiting beliefs, they also need to go out of the way. So actually the second book that I'm publishing later this year is all about this. It talks about making sacred art, the underlying principles, yeah, what my teaching principles are. That's like all very much in that zone. But also like my own paintings, I can hold some of them up here.
Gorgeous, aren't they?
Yeah. So this is about spirit children, actually. This is a painting I made when, you know, you have the northern lights, the aurora borealis that you see like in Iceland or northern Scandinavia and Canada. And some Inuit tribes believe that when you see these northern lights moving and crackling, and it's quite noisy as well, that it was actually the souls of spirit children, so children who had died at or before death, who hadn't lived, but they're up there in the sky playing with their umbilical
cords.
Which
you talk about in your book, don't you?
Spirit children, because you know, I do a lot of work with spirit children. So really it was the spirit children who like opened the door to shamanism for me, who sort of like, you know, they sort of, you know, forced me into this kind of work, but like in a good way. And they would sort of come and say that, you know, like often like when people lose a child, it's, you know, the most dreadful thing that could happen to a human being, and then the child dies and parents have no idea, like, you know, where is the soul of that child now? Is it still anywhere? People have no image of that. No, you know, it's very hard, especially, you know, if you lose a child during pregnancy and you never meet it alive, it's not even fully grown. People don't even have an idea maybe what it would have looked like. So there's like all these like different layers of loss. So then by contacting the souls of these children in the spirit world, and then again in partnership saying to these children, say, you know, do you have a message for the parents? Like, where are you now? And they're happy to show you. And they're often in very beautiful places. They, how would you like to be painted? And then, you know, they show me an image of where they are.
Lovely.
Sometimes, you know, it's swimming with dolphins, or sometimes it's something else altogether. And then you make that painting, and by giving that to the family who's lost the child, they then actually have an image of the child. They have a way of thinking of the child and a setting. And such as them putting that painting on the wall in their house.
Yeah.
It also means that it's like a physical expression of that child.
Physical
itself.
Connection.
Yeah, and it takes its place in the family by being on the wall of the house.
Yeah. And to be able to express through your artwork your spirit work.
Yeah.
Is a wonderful.
But my artwork is my spirit
of
work.
Of course. Well, I mean, it's all connected. But I mean, to be able to express that, because there are some people that work with spirit that don't have that artistic expression. Do you know what I mean?
People work in different ways, but also people can go very deep without artistic expression. And so that, you know, you are like, you know, you're a musician. So people make incredible music without ever getting images, or other people write beautiful poetry, or again, other people, they have a way of talking to nature spirits that makes you want to cry. I mean, they don't make art, but their art form is that communication.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, so.
And it is a communication, isn't
it? Yeah,
whatever
it is,
it's a communication of some kind. Whatever, how that fits into whatever aspect, it doesn't matter. But you're very lucky. And what can you talk about this?
Well, you asked me to bring a painting, but most of these paintings are the size of a door, like they wouldn't fit in here.
So
I'll just bring a really small one. Yeah, they're
this
really
is
massive.
Beautiful.
So this is the Dance of Life. It's just like I once read. It's like a Native American dance. I can't remember the tribe right now. But they do a dance, which is the Dance of Life, where they dance all the stages in human life. They start curled up on the floor like a baby, and then they dance and dance until they have like a stick and they're an old man or woman. This is kind of like a rite of passage, and a kind of also, you know, orientating ourselves and like also accepting that we move through these stages in life. We can't stay young forever, but like we have all of these stages, and then death is the natural outcome. So that's called the Dance of Life. So here in my painting, it starts with like, you know, the embryo growing. And then you have more like a toddler with a little teddy bear dancing. No, and then it becomes like a little girl, which becomes a young woman. And then an older woman, you know, a dancing naked, wild woman. But then eventually, you know, becomes pregnant and has her own child. And then becomes like an
maiden,
elder.
Maiden, the mother of crone.
Yeah. With a few more stages.
Yeah.
Becomes like, you know, the old woman who then eventually collapses on the floor and like dies. So this is the moment of death. And then new life or rebirth comes in the form of the baby again.
Yeah.
So it's like a great circle
of life.
That's like happening, and they express it as a dance. And I thought that's so beautiful. This is on the wall of my own house because I think it's so cool to have that reminder. And also not to become over attached to youth, or, you know, in our society, we all want to look young and stay young. And, you know, I'm not ashamed of my age. I'm 51. I'm thrilled. I've got this far. I hope to live more years. And I'm not going to hide my age. I'm not going to pretend to be younger than I am. I'm a great believer in the dance of life and embodying all of these different aspects. Because it's a privilege doing that.
Yeah.
And living long enough to do that.
Absolutely. I agree with you. And what do you think, how do you see our role as moving into, what do we call it? Eldership.
elders of the community.
Elders of the community. How do you see our roles changing or helping, you know, as and supporting our communities?
Well, I think it's of massive importance. So, like, in every interview I do, I like bang on about it if I get a chance. So I'm glad you're asking, actually. But I think, you know, in our culture, because we're so youth-obsessed and we fear old age, like we don't treat old people very well. I mean, old people, like, they know the old ways. They've lived longer than we have. They have all of that wisdom and all of that knowledge. And in our culture, we don't tap into that. But as a tradition, in tribal cultures, you know, older people, they have the role of being elders of the community. And that includes, like, hosting rites of passage and initiation for younger people. So, like, the elders who are, like, men will take teenage boys, aged, like, 13, 14, away from their mothers and their community, put them through a series of initiations. So, like, also, you know, they grow up and they move through these developmental portals. And then they're ready to return and actually take their place in their communities as young men. So it's moving through a portal where you grow up. And because, like, we have lost the art completely, but young people are wired for that. Their souls crave it. So what you then see is young people start self-initiating. They start, you know, they seek thrill-seeking experiences.
Gangs,
joyriding, alcohol. I mean, just look in the newspaper, just look around you. Or, like, overdoses of other kinds, you know, gang culture. Because, like, on some level, their soul craves that. And because we have lost the art of providing that, like, they seek unsafe expressions of that. And we all know how, you know, young people die of drug overdoses or they end up having very traumatic experiences. So
I suppose they're seeking their own vision quests, aren't they, really?
Well, they are. They are. Yeah, I believe that. But yeah. Because the space isn't held by the job of the elders is to make it a safe experience.
Yeah, they have no support.
They're going to survive and make sense of it and become like responsible grown-ups because of it. But because we don't have that elder support and we don't hold these containers, like we're leaving young people out on a limb with very, very mixed results. Some people in it, young people do initiate themselves and grow up to be really wonderful young people, but also young people who kind of like have such difficult experiences along the way that it marks them for life. That is not what I want for my sons, and it's probably not what you want for your sons.
No, no, I agree. Any kind of help towards that support is important work. I think so.
Usually important work.
Now, can we just touch on? Also, you've just contributed, haven't you, to talking about the circle of life, of which death is a part of that. The Death Walking.
Yeah, the Death Walking book, which is going to be published in July.
With
Moon Books, and the coordinator and one of the authors is Laura Perry. We both know.
Yeah.
And, I'm one of the authors, and I was asked to write a chapter about, young children, young people as soul conductors or death walkers. So these are children who have the energy signature of the shaman, who are often really active at night, as I was as a child, like helping people cross over, working with the souls of the dead. But also, some people have that signature, some children, but they're still very young and they're not ready to do that work. And that then can put pressures on the family and the families that need assistance from a shamanic practitioner in putting certain boundaries and measures in place to reach their peace in the family home until the child is older and ready to do that work. So that's the chapter that I wrote. But other authors have all written about different aspects. Like I know Laura Perry has written about like how not to do things. Death walking can be like a risky thing if you don't know what you're doing. It carries real risks, especially when you're working with the souls of the dead who haven't crossed over. There's always a risk that such a soul, rather than moving on, would sort of attach itself to you, and then you really have a problem. Mm-hmm. So what Laura Perry has written about is the sort of, when you sort of don't receive training in this and you sort of start like inventing the wheel yourself, the things that can go wrong and the things not to do when you do this work.
Okay, and when does that come out, that book?
In July, I think it was the 25th of July, late July this year.
Fantastic, yeah. I'm going to get that.
And I think it's a really important book because it was written actually because, my students often ask before I teach them their like death and dying module, they say, Imelda, have you got some good reading we could do before we come and do that work with you? And actually, there were only very few books I could recommend, and none of them were really that good or that in depth. So that's my reason for making a contribution to that anthology, because there's almost no information out there. And how can we educate the world at large? People cannot find quality books on the subject.
Yeah.
So I think it's a very important book.
Yeah, I agree.
Families have these children who have these, and also if children don't know what's going on and there's things going on at night but they don't know what it is, then parents may think the child just has nightmares, or people mm-hmm. say, don't be silly, there's nothing in your room. While your child is shamanically gifted, there may well be something in the room that needs attention.
Yeah.
So we also need to educate ourselves around not shutting down the experiences our children have.
Mm. And also, I suppose in our culture, in terms of the death and the dying, we have the funeral, the conventional funeral, whereas there are many shamanic rituals, ceremonies that you can do for example, we lost our cat a couple of weeks mm-hmm. ago.
Yeah.
And we buried her in the garden, and we did a little ritual and it was lovely, and that was kind of closure on mm-hmm. her life. And and of course that kind of thing happens all the time. Children lose a pet or, a mm-hmm. grandparent or it happens to all of us. What can you give us an idea of maybe a shamanic ritual that somebody could do themselves at home?
I think it would be really good if people actually, read my
book.
All of these at the end, I have done all of these ceremonies for different occasions.
Yeah.
But what I would say, what I think is more important, because you can really make your own ceremony when you're creative, but I think the thing is that we often want to shield our children from death. Say when in my brother's family, another grandmother died, these children were 8 and 10, and my brother and his wife decided to not take them to church for the funeral, so they were left with my mother, the other grandmother. And it's kind of like that to me, that is crazy. It's like, so rather than shielding our children from death, we don't do them a favor at all. Like, death is part of life. Death feeds life. Death is really everywhere in nature.
To learn to accept it, don't they? So
every time a death, be it a family pet or be it a bird in the forest you see or whatever, that is actually an opportunity to talk to your child and really sort of, you know, but to be able to do that, you need to overcome your own fear of death.
Yeah.
And parents who haven't dealt with that, they are the ones who are not going to be so brilliant talking to children about death. But again, that's an area where we fail our children.
Imelda, we could sit here for hours.
I know.
And, you know, we'd still be talking as the moon rises tonight. But we have to go. But it's been lovely having you. If people wanted to contact you, where would you be contactable?
Through my website. If people just type in my name and Google it, my website will come up. So I have like a contact me button.
And I'll put that in the links in the
show notes. If you put that in the links, people can just like click on there and it goes directly to my inbox. And I pick up all messages and respond as I'm able to do so.
Within 24 hours?
Sometimes, but
depends how busy you are.
If I'm teaching or a long retreat with students, it may be a week.
Yeah. Now, just to finish with, you lead such a busy life. How do you find the balance between work and time for yourself to play?
That can be really difficult, but I think the thing I hold on to is that everything I do is an expression of my own soul, and it's what I enjoy most. So for me, the moment I put joy at the heart of it, like I'm a very fortunate human being, like everything I do is an expression of like my passions in life. So if I just, you know, focus on that, and yeah, like my life is very busy. But then also ultimately, like, I don't mind so much, because if I do everything I do with real passion and joy, then kind of like I don't need to have so much, so to speak, free time.
No.
You dissolve the division between, like, you know, your life's work and your free time.
Yeah, there's no separation, is there really? No, I understand completely what you're saying. Well, on the subject of joy, it's been an absolute joy to have you in the treehouse.
Well, thank you for having me and inviting me.
It's been wonderful. And I hope that everybody else has enjoyed it as much as I have.
Let's hope so.
And it would be lovely for you to come back next year, maybe, when, you know.
I'll hold you to that.
Yeah, and you can talk about how your courses are going in Sweden. I wish you all the luck with that.
Well, thank you very much.
And
thank
you for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you from the treehouse, and we'll see you soon.
Bye.